Have you ever been fascinated by the sheer concept of architecture on water? Have you ever dreamt of learning in a school that floats on water? So the story which we are about to unfold is a dream of a community on water called the Makoko community. So Makoko is a cluster of communities living on water situated across the third mainland bridge on the coast of Lagos. It is a highly dense and urbanized area that has almost no roads, no lands and no infrastructure, and the entire community is built on steel structures and the only means of transportation is by boats. For nearly 100 years, it has thrived on the fishing and the sawing industries, and according to the 2016 reports, there live almost 1 lakh people in the Makoko community. And the only person who believed in fulfilling their dream was none other than architect Kunle Adeyemi from Nigeria.
My name is Kunle Adeyemi and my Africa is full of potential.
And the school which we are talking about is none other than the Makoko Floating School, located in the Makoko community itself. And this community is also known as the Venice of Africa. So let's first understand what exactly is the Makoko School and its brief background. So as the entire community was built on stilts that go deep into the waterbed, so due to the climatic changes, there was a huge problem of flooding where all the cars seemed to float on water, and unfortunately the city too for the major part of the year. And as there were no roads, the only means of transportation was through water, and due to which all the major activities and occupation got hindered due to this problem of flooding. And also the entire community had only one English speaking school which remained shut most of the times of the year due to this problem of flooding, which majorly hindered children's access to education. And the entire real estate being on waterfront, so as an answer to the problem of this community, the idea of the Makoko Floating School was born. So architect Kunle Adeyemi began working on this school in the year 2011 when he first visited this community and observed this burning problem. So basically, Makoko is a city within a city. So the broader framework of today's case study involves the design challenges, the concept behind starting on to design, the spatial planning, structure, the construction process, materials, the climatic response, and also understanding the sustainability of this project, which led to some important lessons that we need to learn from this. And apart from all the lessons, there is one important lesson that we need to take back from this building, which I will be revealing at the very end, which will stay with you for the rest of your life. So please stay tuned till the end of this case study. And now let's understand the challenges this design has posed in front of the architect. So the first problem was to address the challenges of living on water, and the second important aspect was to design a school for this community. So these were the two major burning problems that needed to be solved, but apart from that, the non-transparent and the unseen agenda of this project was to bring them on the formal city maps, as the government had rejected them and also had started evacuating them from their houses. So without any further ado, let's get started into decoding the design. And before starting on to the actual design of this school, architect Kunle Adeyemi studied various other cities like Venice and Amsterdam due to a common element of water, which gave him some conceptual ideas and led him to some conclusions, such as in case of Amsterdam, he put it into the category 1 water city, which has roads to walk or drive cars and bicycles, plus there is a water canal which you can travel through, so the local infrastructure is on ground. And in case of Venice, he categorized it as type 2 water city, which has no roads to drive, so you can only walk by the pathways, and the only means of travel is through water by being on a boat. So here they have infrastructure on ground as well as water. And the third category is the Makoko community, where the entire infrastructure and the entire transport is only on water. So as water formed an integral part of this community, all of his conclusions and studies brought him to one common conclusion that instead of dodging and ignoring water, let's use its potential to solve the problem of this community, and thereby the idea of a floating structure was formulated. And now coming to the planning of the school and understanding its vision to be built in different phases. So the first phase consists of the floating structure which has three levels. So the first level consists of an open play area which can also be used as a community center after the school gets over. And the second level consists of the classrooms for 60 people and in worst cases it can also accommodate around 100 students. And the third level, connected by the staircase, is a semi-enclosed open space for workshops and other activities. The students come to the school by means of a boat, so the boat acts as a school bus for them. So this was all about the zoning of the phase 1 of the structure. The phase 2 consists of using the structure as a housing by following the same aesthetic and functional principles as the school. And the third phase consists of developing an entire community out of this module by replacing the existing stilt houses with these floating buildings and maintaining an improved quality of life.
And I decided this was a great place to learn how they built, how they achieved so much with so little. One of the first things I learned was the very basic ways of building with local materials. And I was asked by one of the community members if I could help with a school that was flooding.
So Kunle Adeyemi decided to build a school in Makoko by using the same methods, materials and workers as the community used. However, his approach was innovative. He wanted to make the school float instead of building it on traditional stilts. In Makoko, a three-story building is a first, and it's a floating one, no less.
It's a prototype structure, which in this instance is a school, but it's essentially a structure that could be used for other things. It could be converted into a home.
When I finished it up, everybody was happy that, oh, this is a floating structure. And probably they can't build structure like this in your community and you won't be proud of it.
Climate change will certainly influence the way we think about our environment, and hopefully the architecture should also respond to such influence.
And now let's look at the construction of how exactly this module was erected. So be it their urban life or social life or the aesthetics of the region or even the challenges for that matter, everything has a connection to water. And as earlier also, the houses that were built there in the community were built on stilts. So the architect just replaced the stilts with a floating platform which consisted of plastic barrels which was found in abundance in the entire community. So basically it was nothing but an upgradation of the existing typology itself.
In most of the cases here, the buildings are on stilts, which means the rising sea levels, they are subject to flooding, but we found a way to allow the structure to float and adapt to the changing tidal conditions.
So using the existing construction typology and the global floating technology, he came up with a solution that was primarily an A-frame structure that was supported on a base of 10 meter by 10 meter wooden grid supported by around 250 wooden barrels below. So this entire wooden base was divided into 16 wooden modules. Each consisted of 16 plastic barrels tied to each other which could float the entire platform. And before finalizing on the triangular structure, various other options were tried out from the stability and also the climatic point of view. But the triangle turned out to be one of the most stable form as it has very low center of gravity and its ability to drain water due to its sloping form. And for the construction of this module, local unskilled laborers were involved in this process, and the idea behind involving these local laborers was that after the construction of this school, they could construct their own houses with the same technology just by replacing it with the floating barrel technology. So firstly, the base platform is built and on top of that, the A-frame structure is erected. So it is a floating structure, and when the water level goes up, the structure also tends to rise up, and when the water level goes down, the structure comes down too. Hence, it is a floating structure that is stable, scalable and adaptable to various other uses such as a housing, a health clinic, a market, an entertainment hub, or even for that matter, an infrastructure hub. And now coming to the frugal use of materials used in the construction of this school. The floating school uses all local materials that are found in and around this community. The foundation raft is assembled with wooden frames and plastic barrels, and the A-frame superstructure is assembled with hardwood beams and bamboo joists, with wood also used as an infill material and the bamboo used for the louvers of this school. So wood and bamboo consisted of the major materials that were used for the structural support as well as the finishing of the school that was procured from the local sawmill. And the roofing was assembled with local aluminium sheets. And also when you look at the climatic aspect of the school, it is quite sensitive to the climate around in terms of including louvers for the A-frame triangular structure which enables maximum cross ventilation. And also it uses the stack ventilation where the hot air due to its low density rises and the cool air is supplied from below, thereby maintaining a comfortable environment inside the school. And despite having budget constraints and also demonstrating lessons of frugal innovations, the architect worked rigorously in creating a standalone, self-sustainable module that could generate its own food and power, thereby carefully detailing each and every aspect to maximize its sustainable features. So the three major sustainable features used in the structures was the rainwater harvesting, where water was collected from the roof in the barrels below and then later on it can be used by a simple concept of collect, store and use. And secondly, the use of composting toilets, where the waste gets collected in the barrels below and after treatment it can be used as a fertilizer to grow food on the module itself. And thirdly, using PV panels on the roof that could generate its own electricity that could run the lights and fans in the classrooms. So the plastic barrels below perform a dual function of floating the entire structure and also supporting the entire structure in these sustainable features. So mentioning about the sustainable features in this video is just like a scratch on the surface, but if you would really like to go in detail into understanding all of these aspects, I've attached a study material in the description below, so you can have a look at it after this video. And when talking about the future possibility of this structure, its replica had already started in 5 different countries across 3 continents from its construction in the Makoko community. As 80% of the world's major cities are situated by water and many of them which face the problem of flooding and growing rapidly, especially the African and Asian countries. Therefore, this Makoko school prototype will prove to be a great adaptable and flexible solution in all of these regions. And now coming to the last and the most important part, that is, what are the lessons that we need to take back from this iconic case study, as there are many lessons that we can take back. But the most important lesson I will be revealing at the end, so please stay tuned till the end. So the first lesson that it teaches us is of thinking globally and acting locally. So even if the concept of floating may not be new, but the sheer way in which it is adapted to the local technology by using plastic barrels that are found in abundance in the community itself, and the resultant solution is not only an answer to the local Makoko community, but to the worldwide global communities that face the same problem of flooding. So it is an old technique which is adapted in new innovative ways to adapt and scale to provide a global solution. And the second important lesson that it teaches us is to look at slum as a place of opportunities. So whenever we hear the word slum, the words that come to mind are dark, drab and filth, which creates a sense of discomfort. But what if I tell you a slum is a place of opportunities where there is life adjustment in a multifaceted way with deep-rooted values? And this is the exact point with which the architect has taken into consideration to look at it as a place of opportunities by using their own technology in new contemporary ways, which instills a sense of pride and most importantly a sense of ownership in them. And thirdly, it has become a true beacon of hope in the entire community. So when you look at the aerial view of the Makoko community, all you can see is the thick black air fumes, smoke seeping out of the wood burning kilns and smoke houses around with a labyrinth of canals, and the Makoko certainly stands out as a true beacon of hope of the entire community, not only physically but also in the hearts of the people, as a bottom-up solution for the future. And fourthly, learning from the community itself and giving them back with a robust solution By involving them in the construction process and later on people taking up the sense of ownership has truly proved to be a solution of the people, for the people and by the people. So in this case, the architect has merely acted as an agent to compose the ideas of this community. Therefore, it is a fusion of two brains, that is the architect and the community. And fifthly, the structure is largely flexible, as after the school gets over, it is used as a community center all day long and even functions as a theater in the night. It also has the ability to become a library, a museum, restaurant or even a house for the community. So function-wise, it is quite flexible, and globally it is also adaptable due to its modular form. And the next important lesson that it teaches us is of defense. So while the government was busy fighting with water and building large multi-story buildings on the land, the Makoko community lived safely on stilts above the waterline, which teaches us instead of defending the water, we can live with it. And this resourceful and innovative idea itself inspired architect Kunle Adeyemi for his floating system. And lastly, as many architects around were building large-scale skyscrapers which got them fame and recognition, but architect Kunle Adeyemi instead decided to aim for impact over fame while working with his community to provide them a tangible solution. And the impact was not only limited to the community but also to the government officials, which had earlier rejected them as they were not present on the formal city maps. So this intervention really gave a hope to the government officials that it can be converted into a workable solution, and the Lagos State Ministry of Physical Planning and Urban Development considered it incorporating into the regeneration of Makoko plan. So your ideas have the power to bring about a change in the society. And coming to the last and the most important lesson from this case study is that as the school got demolished due to heavy rains and storms, there were a lot of debates over its demolition. But the most important lesson that we need to take back, even if the physical structure may have toppled down, it has injected the thinking germ in the minds of the community of all the possibilities of solutions to their problems, and has set the ball rolling to think of many other such possibilities to their problems. And also it is an answer to the demolition that happens to the architectural buildings all across the country. So the only lesson we as architects can take from this is that buildings may die physically, but the idea never dies. So that's all from my side for today, guys. I hope you found this video useful, and please do not forget to hit the like and subscribe button below in order to never miss an update, and do let me know below in the comments what are the top 3 takeaways from this case study.